Why the hell do they call themselves Failure?
That's the biggest 90s name ever, right? All these self-doubting early 90s. Come on. I mean, it's nail on the head for the time.
It really is.
Anyway, yeah. Sorry.
Hey everybody, and welcome. You join us in a break in the action at the World Black Pudding Throwing Championships.
Yeah,
it is a thing. Check. So we have just enough time to crack open another episode of the Audiophiles before we return to Ramsbottom, and it is a place. Americans, check. So
sounds like it.
I'm gonna stop myself responding. You got a song for me to listen to, Andy?
Yeah, I do. I've mentioned this song or this band before to you, and you've actually heard their material, but not by them. You heard their material as covered by A Perfect Circle. This band is called Failure. And they are a bit of a cult following band from the 90s. And I happen to really, really, really like this album a lot. And the track off of it that I'm going to give you is called Stuck on You. So this won't be The Nurse Who Loved Me, their original rendition of it. This is another track off that album.
I have heard Failure. I actually went out and checked out their version of the Nurse Who Shagged Me, or whatever it's called.
Oh, you went off and listened to that independently.
Yeah,
did you?
I was intrigued. Fair play. It was decent. I mean, I really, just because it was so beautiful, I preferred A Perfect Circle's version. But yeah, it was decent. So that's the only song of theirs I've heard.
Okay, cool. Well, then you've heard them, and this is off that same album. But yeah, go off and give Stuck on You a listen.
Okie dokie.
Cool.
I like that start with the quirky electronic, slightly retro sound, just a little bit distorted. That sounds nice. And then immediately you're into sounds to me like a mid-90s alt rock sound. Melody's quite nice though, and it's got a really full sound, heavy bass. Sounds good. Let's see what happens next.
I heard you driving in my car, then in a frozen bar. I claimed I didn't care. Inside my head, over and over again, you played yourself to death. Dreams, turn my nights to sleep.
Okay, there's a lot going on here. There's a few things I really like. And the bass is excellent. He's not going up and down, but it sounds fantastic. The drummer is giving it the full caveman. You know, it's pounding, simplistic, but it really works well. All the fills are really simple. There's nothing flash or showy, but it really grabs your attention. And that chorus, it's really full, but it's quite an open sound as well, and it's catchy. Yeah, this is good stuff.
Holding on the telephone, I hear your mid-range moan. You're everywhere inside my room. Even when I'm alone, I hear your melody. You're everywhere inside of me. Stuck on you till the end of time. I'm too tired to fight.
Drummer got under my skin. That was excellent. Catchy song as well. Full guitars, great bass. I think he might have been singing some words, but I only heard Stuck on You. Shite. Andy's gonna kill me.
All right, you're back. So,
So quick it seems, doesn't
yeah,
it?
it does lightning fast. We're gonna make this black pudding throwing contest in no time. So,
I've got pictures. If anyone doubts me, I've got photographs. I
given
actually
most
went
our
across to
audience
them
is from the
anyway.
UK, I'm sure they believe you, and I know enough about the UK to take your word for it.
Anyway, back to Stuck on You. So this was interesting. This really quirky electronic intro that was like quite retro. And slightly distorted as well, so it felt cheap's the wrong word, but you know, I mean, like it was like budget, you know, sound to feel to it. But it's a really nice melody, and then in comes this sort of classic mid-90s alt-rock sound, you know, that just you might as well place a pin on a time map, you know, exactly within a couple of years where it is, bang, you know, and it places you there and you know where you are, you know your surroundings, you know people are wearing those sort of check shirts that look like lumberjack shirts, and you know all that's happening. You feel quite comfortable because you know where you are. I've got my bearings. So yeah, I found this really interesting. So it kind of is not two parts, but there is a contrast between the verses and the choruses. And the verses with the strumming and the bass working together, it reminded me of quite of a gentle Pavement sound, you know, in terms of that band, which I was interesting. But the chorus had just a touch of the Nirvanas about it, with the chord changes, not the overall sound, but the way it did it. But it was a massive sound to the chorus. It was really full. But at the same time, if this isn't contradictory, it was really open as well and sort of sweeping almost.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very catchy sing-along chorus. I felt that the bass was excellent. It wasn't very I mean, the guitars get all the headlines, obviously, because they're like right in your face, you know. But the bass, I thought, was excellent. It wasn't showy, but it really grabbed my attention. It's just like you notice somebody doing something really well, even if it's doing something simple, but really well. And it's very pleasing. And that's what it was. But the drummer, oh my God, that was just top notch. Again, he starts off fairly sort of perfunctory. Not that showy at all, but huge power, but economical, you know. So he's doing this stuff and it's really punctuating it, but it's all, you know, it's fairly economical, nothing to it. And there's some lovely fills, which then did get more expansive towards the end. And I found myself waiting for the next one, you know, because they were great and it was sounding, and it was that proper, you know, it wasn't John Bonham, but it had that sort of feel to it, like the power and the sort of aggression, you know, without being over the top.
Over the top, right.
It was really, really lovely. And the other thing that... the other thing that I really liked was, it's really odd that the only sort of change that they did was right at the end, where they sort of went to the different chord changes. But it was right at the end of the song and then brought it out rather than sort of like a bridge in the middle or whatever, you know, which again was an interesting choice. Overall, it had a lovely sound. I really enjoyed it. And I think that the drumming in particular, but also the bass, pushed it from decent to really enjoyable. I was so swept up in the music side of things that the only lyrics I caught was Stuck on You. So it's either an incident or a super glue factory, or perhaps it's something about a relationship. I don't know, but thank God you're here to tell me what the lyrics are and what it means. But overall, I really enjoyed this, actually. I really enjoyed it a lot. And it was a lot to like about it. And, you know, it's of its time, I think, and it felt of that place as well, you know, which is no bad thing in my book. This is good stuff.
Awesome. Yeah. Big fan of this album. And for what they've put out, this band, they're an interesting group. They're one of those, like, have you ever heard like the term, like, your favorite comedian's favorite comedian, or your favorite band's favorite band? These are that favorite band of another band who had far more success around the same time or shortly thereafter. And what's interesting is that there is a documentary about them that's being worked on right now. And contributors to that, people who wanted very much to be part of this, were Tommy Lee, the drummer for Motley Crue, who adores them. Jason Schwartzman, who is an actor. He's in a lot of Wes Anderson films. He's also a musician. Then there was Butch Vig, who is like a big 90s producer and the drummer for Garbage. Brian Albert, the singer and guitarist for Silver Sun Pickups. Maynard James Keenan, for obvious reasons, knowing what you know about The Nurse Who Loved Me, and Margaret Chow, the actress and comedian. So this is an interesting group of people who all really wanted to come out and talk about this band that they all loved. They are an American alternative rock band from Los Angeles that was active from 90 to 97. Then they took a hiatus because there's friction in the band and some personal issues that some of the members were going through. And then they sort of got back together in 2014 and have put out new music and are still currently together. And they've released 6 full-length albums and 5 EPs. So this album, Fantastic Planet, is the 3rd studio album from them, and it was released in 96. And I guess what's interesting about this song is that this was the first single from it, and it really only got like low to medium rotation on MTV. I think it charted in like, it reached 23 on Billboard's alternative song charts, but that was kind of like the apex of their commercial success. But like I said, you can't really underscore enough how important this band was to a lot of other musicians around the same time. Especially as pioneers in the space rock sound, which I think this album really kind of leans into and even owns. I mean, look at the cover of it, you know, and the name Fantastic Planet. So there's a lot of fun stuff happening sonically in this album that I think was kind of, you know, newish at the time and really blew a lot of the people, some of the aforementioned people's minds when they heard it for the first time. And I thought that this was an interesting anecdote from a snippet of that documentary that I saw, that is actually your fellow Butch Vig, the drummer for Garbage, who said, the main riff on Stuck on You sounds like an SOS beam being beamed from some other galaxy. And that's the first thing he thought of when he first heard that that intro riff, that. So it's very, very catchy. The first time I heard it, God, that riff got stuck in my head forever. And it kind of, when it all comes in together, it kind of hits you in the chest, how loud and I don't want to say aggressive, but just maybe to coin a term you often use, muscular, that sound is when it hits you. But yeah, this the lyrics are kind of a double entendre, and I'll go through and read them and see if you kind of pick up on what it is. I heard you driving in my car, then in a frozen bar, I claimed I didn't care for you. But your verse got trapped inside my head over and over again. You played yourself to death in me. I thought I'd drop you easily, but that was not to be. You burrowed like a summer tick. So you invade my sleep and confuse my dreams, turn my nights to sleepless itch. Stuck on you to the end of time, I'm too tired to fight your rhyme. Stuck on you to the end of time, you've got me paralyzed. Holding on the telephone, I hear your mid-range moan. You're everywhere inside my room. Even when I'm all alone, I hear your mellow drone. You're everywhere inside of me. Stuck on you till the end of time. I'm too tired to fight your rhyme. Stuck on you till the end of time. You've got me trapped. And this is sort of where it changes musically kind of a little bit and opens up. You've got me trapped. I can't escape your incessant whine. When you beam it out all across the sky. No, I can't escape your insipid rhyme when you shoot it deep straight into my mind. So, you're a smart fellow. This is probably like, on face value, it's like, oh, this is a guy who's hung up on a girl.
Okay, yeah, but it's not a very pleasant hang up, is it?
No.
Even if you took it on face value. But, yeah, there's just some words in there that sort of like, did it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Summer tick, sleepless itch, obvious mellow. And, what was it? Shoot. Fuck, I just wrote this down a minute ago. Something, shoot something deep.
Yeah, when you shoot it deep, straight into
shoot it deep. It's deep. Fuck's sake.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so that's obviously a dependency on artificial sweetness.
Yeah, that's exactly what it is. Saccharin.
Yeah, exactly. No, it's obviously whatever the drug du jour is that he's talking about. I'd imagine. Yeah. I mean, the sleepless itch, you know, summer ticks are really interesting use.
I love that, especially when you get to what this is, you know what I mean? Like, this is an intravenous drug. They were much wrapped up in the heroin scene of the 90s.
Right.
That was going along with a lot of this sort of alt rock happening. You know,
Dirty Smack. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, this is, God, this is a, sadly a reoccurring theme where it's almost like no matter what the genre is, there's always this pocket of like really hard narcotics use that's being done, oftentimes by some of the most talented but most troubled individuals in that genre. And these guys were definitely some of those fellows that were, and by the way, it's Ken Andrews, Greg Edwards, and Kelly Scott, but I believe Andrews and Edwards are kind of like the two mains, like the two main guys in the band and the songwriters. And yeah, they were very much wrapped up in that heroin scene. And the, but there's something so, well, one, this is a very vulnerable song. So hats off to them to be able to like take themselves apart lyrically and come up with this, this beautiful art. But like all this, like, the, you know, you burrowed like a summer tick. That's something that certainly has to do with blood. You know what I mean? And then sleepless itch.
So, can I just ask, have you ever deticked your dog?
Oh yeah. I mean, I grew up deer country, Pennsylvania, you know, rural. So we had a 10-acre farm and labs that ran all over the place. We had a yellow lab and a black lab that kind of just had full run. And we had a wooded lot behind our house that was a few acres big. And yeah, goddamn, those things like this, so big, like the size of a nickel. And they're gross and disgusting. And a summer tick is like,
you can't get them until they're big enough.
Yes.
And we never really got them around where we live. It's only when we went to France with the dogs that they picked them up. And it's usually like the following week when you're back home and suddenly there's a lump and it's this disgusting thing. Mm. So we got the Twizzler, it's called. It's like a little plastic thing with a fork.
Yeah,
and it gets under the head. A big end and a little end. And you put it in and twist it round. So, of course, if you try and rip them out, they leave their jaws and the skin.
Yeah, yeah.
And when you twizzle it round and bring this thing out, and you can see its tiny sort of jaws sort of waving. And you think, you are disgusting creature,
yeah,
and
yeah,
it's filled with your pet's blood, and you want to smash it, or you know, you're like, burn the bastard.
But yeah, we used to burn them all the time. Burn them or flush them. That was always the thing, like in the toilet.
But it's such a great image because I just felt all of that just for those two words.
I know, like, If you've encountered them, instantly you get hit with imagery of like how gross. Oh. You know, they are. And yeah, that's a visceral line for me too. It hits me every time I hear it. And it's just, obviously it's not about like being, or perhaps it can be, but it's clearly about an addiction. I mean, this song is there's too many illusions for it to
well, it's not a relationship of sorts anyway, isn't it?
Isn't not it? Yes, absolutely.
It's with a relationship with not just a concept, I guess, but this thing that dominates your life, you know.
Absolutely.
And like you said, you know, it's true. You go back through the years, you know, Charlie Parker, Miles Davis, and loads of people before then, mm-hmm, in the 30s, they were doing smack, you know. It's always been around, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, it has. And it's a shame. And there's probably, you know, countless songs for every genre about this same plight. But yeah, it's sad. A little synopsis here says the song has two interpretations. One being that he wants to get over a girl that's trapped within his head. Two, he tries and gets addicted to heroin, and this is his experience with it. Use of heroin and other opioids can make the user feel a little itchy, leading to difficulty sleeping despite sedative effects of the drug. So yeah, this is what the song is about. And yeah, it's heavy material, but God, I just love the sonic landscape of this song. I love just the wall of noise you get hit with when it fully realizes itself. And I do like the ending where it takes it up and he kind of like,
it's almost, and it's just really unexpected because it's right at the end as well.
Yeah. And it is like a plea, you know, it almost has this pleading quality about it, which obviously he's in a state where he's looking for an out, or to no longer be stuck on this thing that is burrowed itself within. So, anything else you want to say, John, before I wrap this up?
No, it's really interesting. And thanks. It's from, you know, The Nurse Who Loved Me to this is quite interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. There's a couple other ones that I have possibly down the line to pull out for you that are another, I think, some of the most influential songs that they've done. So, I'll look forward to maybe digging those up in the future and hand them over to you. But with all that being said, everybody out there, thank you so much for tuning in. If you are a fan of Failure, or perhaps even this song or album in particular, feel free to jump in the comments. John?
Yeah, just to stop you there. Why the hell do they call themselves Failure?
That's the biggest 90s name ever, right? All the self-doubting early 90s. Come on. I mean, it's nail on the head for the time.
It really is.
By all means. No, yeah, it kind of makes me laugh a little bit too, because could there be any more like white male self-doubt early 90s rock band name than just Failure, calling yourself as you see it or as you feel? Anyway, all that being said, folks, and on a high note, thank you so much for giving us your time. Like, share, subscribe. Again, jump in the comments field if you'd like to. And until we give a next rifling through the audio files, we will catch you on the next episode. See you guys.